everybody. I'm Crandall.
I'm Mercy.
We are Armchair Directors.
And this ain't that kind of movie, bruv.
We are back on the couch. You asked for it. You demanded it. So here it is.
And we're going to give you a moment to savor it right now. All right, let's get on with the review. Actually, before we do the review, we want to talk a little bit about Twitter. I'm finally giving Twitter another chance. I signed up for it like 2009 or something, years ago, never really got into it, but giving it another shot. So give me a follow at Michael Mercy. He's at Matt Crandall.
Yep.
Collectively, we are at Armchair Guys. And so check us out on Twitter, and we want to give away some more Blu-rays. So Twitter is an easier way of following who shared our stuff than Facebook is, with the Facebook privacy laws. We were never really sure who,
right.
who shared
who was it. Really sharing it.
Twitter is going to be very easy. Retweet this review. We can see everyone who retweeted it. It's going to be posted on Armchair Guys. And we're going to enter all the names into a draw and give away a Blu-ray. We have tons of Blu-rays in our collection. They're going to be signed by both Matt and I, personalized to you. So retweet on Twitter, spread the word about Armchair Directors, and win yourself a Blu-ray.
Absolutely. So now we are going to take a look at Matthew Vaughn's Kingsman: The Secret Service.
And I was split on this one. I was a little conflicted because I loved X-Men First Class.
Yep.
Fantastic movie. Really grabbed you by the throat. But the commercial for this movie seemed like a children's movie, at least the first trailer I saw. It felt like kind of a Disney-ish, we're training secret agents. But then I saw Firth,
right.
And that's the only reason I went to see this movie, Firth.
Yeah.
You had me at Firth. And if you want to win me over, start your movie with Money for Nothing.
Oh, yeah.
Amazing beginning to this movie, and just really stylish, classy, and not that kind of movie, bruv.
Like, right.
It really goes against conventions. It's not predictable. The kid who stars in this thing, who is rumored to possibly be up for Han Solo in a Han Solo prequel, doesn't look like Harrison Ford, but exudes that roguish charisma and confidence. So he owned it. You know, it's a tough thing to step into the shoes, fill the shoes of Colin Firth, but that kid definitely did it. And then how could you not love Samuel L. Jackson with a lisp?
Sam Jackson with a lisp is just so awesome in a movie like this.
Because he's still Sam Jackson.
Yeah, he's still Samuel L. Jackson, but Valentine's one of my favorite villains so far this year, for sure. Just because he's well-intentioned, but he's got this maniacal plan. And he's watched all these spy movies, and Sam Jackson is basically just playing Sam Jackson with a lisp,
but it's
perfect.
But he hates blood.
I love that he can't stand the sight of blood. He freaks out when he sees any violence. He can't even hear it in one pivotal scene. He doesn't even want to hear it. And it's just a nice twist. So this movie, definitely, Matthew Vaughn has upped his game. He's been working towards a movie like this, because this definitely feels like the tone of Kick-Ass merged with X-Men First Class, and wrap James Bond or layer cake into there, and you get sort of this thing. So Matt Vaughn really has been working towards this movie, it feels like, his whole career, and it definitely pays off. Very entertaining. From start to finish, you're just going to have a blast.
Mm-hmm.
My only negatives of this movie is that there are sometimes where the tone doesn't quite gel for me. There's a great, intense action scene in a church, like the Westboro Baptist Church.
Jesus.
Where it's one of the most visceral, violent, gritty, like, action scenes, high adrenaline, but then they kind of make you feel bad for enjoying the visceral, action-packed adrenaline of that scene, and that's fine, but the movie wants you to be gleeful and enjoying it, but then it shames you for it, and I feel like they needed to walk that tightrope a little bit better.
It's that whole, are you not entertained type of thing from Gladiator. Yeah, the movie is all across the board. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not your typical movie. It really does strive to step away from the boring, tired conventions of all other movies. And I like that almost always, except for my worst part. So let's go into best part.
Worst part.
All right. My best part is Firth. Like I said, Colin Firth is freaking awesome.
He is awesome.
And I was never really a big fan of his until I saw The King's Speech. No one does profanity like Colin Firth. It just cracks me up anytime he swears. Shit.
Yeah.
He's so damn classy about it, even swearing. So he's fantastic in this movie. He's not in the whole thing. Won't spoil it for you, but I was satisfied. I didn't feel gypped that I didn't get enough Firth. I mean,
yeah, it's not a cheat or anything.
I could probably, I could get 5 minutes of Firth and feel satisfied.
Yeah.
Worst part of this movie is it's kind of awkward. I don't know how to come out. I'm just going to come out and say with it. Say it. Worst part, anal sex.
And that goes towards the tone again.
Right. What I really enjoyed about this movie was even though it was slick and hip and current, they still brought in this aspect of old-fashioned gentleman, gentlemanship type of thing. That's what Colin Firth's character is all about, teaching this young man how to be classy, how to be a gentleman.
Manners maketh man.
Manners make a man. And so then to have this female character who's this princess who kind of stands for what's right and stands apart from everyone else, and she won't go along and be a scumbag like everyone else is. And then to have her, you know...
Well, and it escalates so quickly because it's like, it comes out of left field. And yes, it's a line that gets a laugh when you watch it with an audience.
Right, but at what price?
But at what price? Because that is one of those tonal moments that I was talking about where, like, the movie is preaching this one message and then it has something that's completely against what it's been saying the whole time.
And that would just be kind of lost in the shuffle and not a big deal. But when you end this fantastic movie on anal sex, like on that note, and the movie's over, I wonder, there's probably a lot of guys who are going to think that's awesome and funny, but I'm wondering how many girls you're going to alienate and how many gentlemen you're going to alienate and just piss all this fantastic effort away.
It felt like, and so this is based on a graphic novel by Mark Miller.
Yeah.
So like Mark Miller loves to put in stuff like that in his work, and it just felt like Mark Miller fan service that they included that when everything else Vaughn was doing the whole time went against that.
Yeah, wrong placement. If you want to put it in there, that's fine, but don't put it at the end of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
I forgot, honorable mention, Mark Hamill. He's awesome in this thing. Even though he gets the shit kicked out of him, it was awesome to see Mark Hamill on the big screen again before The Force Awakens.
So, worst part, I had already mentioned that basically sometimes the tone doesn't work. So other times you're having a blast, it feels like a throwback, but then they throw in some weird non sequiturs, or it's just... This movie is a hyper-violent movie, but then it's condemning hyper-violence and all that stuff. So it's, you can't really have it both ways. If you want to be that thing, just be that thing. Don't be that thing, but say, yeah, we know this thing is bad. So I didn't like that aspect of it. My other worst part is that once this movie is over, it ends on that weird note. And then they have the worst pop song. Like,
you know, this poor girl is going to think, what, my ass is in there? You have a lovely bottom, miss. Yeah. It's just...
It ends on this horrible, like, power ballad pop tune about the Kingsman Secret Service when the movie has had great music up until then.
Started on Money for Nothing.
Like, we get Money for Nothing. We get stuff like Freebird. Like, it's awesome.
Yeah.
And then they end it with the stupidest, cheesiest, like, Take That doing a song about the Kingsman. What the hell?
Yeah.
So, like, as you're leaving the theater, you're just like, what am I leaving the theater to? Because you want to be pumped up and high-fiving, and that goes to just that. Sometimes the tone doesn't work on this. That being said, this is still one of my favorite movies of the year.
Yep,
I did love most of it. And best part, the casting on this was pitch perfect. So, Firth is awesome. I love seeing Mark Strong in a likable role where he's actually starting to become more likable on screen.
Yeah.
Imitation Game, he was great. He's great in this. And Taron Egerton, who Matthew Vaughn has been saying for months, like, this kid was going to be a thing.
Yeah,
and then now that we see him in this, this kid is going to be the next big thing if he picks the right roles.
He's a natural.
Because he's definitely got the potential. And then you got Michael Caine just showing up, just being Michael Caine for a couple of scenes. And that's fine. Like, you can't go wrong with that.
Mark Hamill.
I think... perfect casting. And Hamill, it was just fun.
And he got to kind of do his Joker voice a little bit.
He did do it a little bit. And of course, so that being said, I love the cast, and the action beats are fun and fantastic, and I do love all the exploding head, all the exploding heads.
Pomp and circumstance, that scene yeah. is amazing.
Hilarious.
So Kingsman is definitely worth your time and money. Go and check it out.
Absolutely.
Thanks a lot for watching, and until next time.
Enjoy the show.
This whiskey is amazing. You will shit.